Hello and welcome to Soft Power. I'm Gino Wong. We are honored to have a special guest here with us today from National Geographic's Dangerous Encounter, Dr. Brady Barr. Welcome, Doctor.
Hey, it's great to be here.
Well, Dr. Brady Barr has done some truly incredible things and knows a great ton about reptiles. In fact, so much so that to call him a reptile expert would be an understatement. He's the first person to ever capture all live 23 species of crocodilians in the wild. And he has handled so many snakes in all sizes, shapes, and forms that an anaconda to ordinary people like you and me would probably be like, an earthworm to you?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I love them all, that's for sure.
Well, absolutely. And snakes is just what we got it here in Taiwan. Taiwan is a subtropical island, and we have a huge variety of all kinds of animal species, including snakes. And I know that you've handled countless snakes in your life. And are there any snakes that you like that can only be found here in Taiwan?
Well, you know, that's the amazing thing about Taiwan, and that's why I'm so interested in this place, is all the number of endemic species you have, meaning species that are found nowhere else in the world. I mean, they're only found here on this island. That's why this is a very, very special place. I think 30% of all reptiles found here are endemics, which is just almost unheard of. 30% of all amphibians are endemics. That's why it's a really special place. You guys need to take care of this place.
Are those snakes mostly venomous or non-venomous?
Well, you have a number of venomous species here, and you also have a number of non-venomous. So, you know, a good rule of thumb is, if you ever see a snake, don't pick it up. I mean, you know, feel lucky that you've seen it, but don't try to handle it, because it's not easy to determine what's venomous and what's not venomous.
Well, we know that there's a rule of thumb, if you will, is that if a snake's head is triangular, more or less, it's venomous. And if it's roundish, then it's all right. Does that work 100% of the time?
If you follow that rule, you're a dead man. I don't know who told you that, but that's not a friend of yours. No, I mean, the world's a big place, and it depends on where you're at on the planet if you want to come up with rules of what's venomous and non-venomous. But I know a lot about snakes, but I don't pick up anything that I can't readily identify, you know, if I'm somewhere in the planet. If I went out on the island today and we found some snakes, and I'm not that familiar with snakes here in Taiwan, I wouldn't pick up anything.
But you pick up all the snakes that on your show. It's like you handle every single snake. Like, you know everything about snakes.
No. Look. I know a lot about snakes. I know a lot about crocs, but I don't claim to know everything. When you claim to know everything, you aren't in the business very long. You're dead. I mean, safety is of the utmost importance.
Well, speaking of snakes and identifying snakes, can you tell me what you know about this, what do you call it? Is it a python?
This is a boa.
It's a boa.
This guy's from my part of the world. This is from the Americas right here. This is a boa constrictor. And as you can see, it's hard to get him off your wrist.
Yeah, he was just wrapping around my,
That's why they call it a constrictor. It's a boa constrictor. These guys kill by constriction, meaning they're very strong. They wrap their prey up and they squeeze it so tightly
that the
prey falls into cardiac arrest. Your heart can't pump blood through your body, and you can't breathe. So that's how powerful these snakes are. They have 10,000 muscles in their body. It's a lot like
me. Just feeling it around my arm, and it's like every piece of muscle. I can feel the muscle inside. I thought it was going to be like one squishy.
No.
It's not. It's really firm.
This is small. I mean, constrictors are the biggest snakes on the planet. They can, you know, push 10 meters. You know, 9-meter constrictor is a monster. And it would kill you in a matter of minutes if you ran into it by yourself.
Is that why snakes have the bad rep? Like, why do people so inherently fear snakes?
Well, you know, I don't know if I agree with you there, but what I will say is that on a universal scale, all over the planet, people always have an opinion about snakes.
Yeah.
Some are terrified, some are horrified, some are intrigued, some are passionate about them. It's unlike any other animal. It's like you never get anybody that says, snakes, I don't really have anything to say about them. And I don't know what it is. On television, National Geographic, We film darn near every animal on the planet. The one animal that rates higher than any other animal, snakes. And you know why I think that is? I think that everybody has a snake story. You don't have crocodiles here in Taiwan.
Not a lot we don't.
We don't have crocodiles in the state of Indiana where I grew up. But there are snakes just about everywhere. Everybody has a snake story or knows somebody that has a snake story. And I think that that's why we can all relate to snakes, because we've had some kind of interaction with them. And they're tied up in so many religious beliefs. They're in numerous, you know, religions. Nothing looks like a snake. It doesn't have any arms, no legs, no outward ears, no fingers or toes. I mean, it's just a bizarre looking beast.
Yeah. Why? Well, actually, it's funny you should bring up that they are sometimes, snakes are actually, they're sometimes feared, and sometimes they're highly respected. We have an indigenous tribe in Taiwan, and that they see those snakes as like a status symbol. That would put a snake pattern on their ceramics, on their clothes, and only people of higher social status can put those snake pattern on their robes.
Wow, that's fascinating. And I'd like to meet those guys.
Why? I know that you've been snakes. You've come into a lot of encounters with snakes, and you've been bitten by snakes a couple of times. Can you tell me what it was like for you? I know you've been bitten in the face even.
Yeah, I have. I've been bitten a number of times, but again, you know, I'm really careful. I love these animals, but I don't want to die. And if you get complacent or you get foolish or, you know, you take chances, you're not going to be around long. I've never been bitten by a venomous snake, nothing bad. So I said, this is a constrictor. I've had some very bad bites, and from these guys right here. Lots of folks think that snakes have just two fangs, and if they bite you, it's going to be two fang marks.
That's what I thought, too.
No. These guys have over 100 highly recurved, needle-sharp teeth, and they don't bite and let go. These guys use their bite as an anchoring point. So they will bite, latch on, and use that as an anchoring
point,
then throw the coils around the prey. These guys give you horrible bites because they're these 100 tearing teeth, and if you try to pull them, the teeth are recurved. So what's your reaction?
The harder you pull, yeah.
You grab the snake and pull, and it just drives those teeth further down, and it's a really bad bite. In a big one, you know, say a 5, 6, 7 meter python, you know, it'll have a head almost the size of a human head, teeth about the size of your fingers, and that is just a horrific bite.
That just seals the deal for
you. It's something you don't want to experience. And I ran into one in a cave a few years ago, and it's called the bite heard around the world, because, man, you could hear me screaming around the world.
You've been bitten. Why are you not afraid of snakes? Because we have a Chinese saying here in Taiwan that once you've been bitten by a snake, you will fear even ropes in the next decade to come. Why are you not afraid of snakes?
Well, look, I'm passionate about these animals, and I've dedicated my career to try to protect them and raise awareness, conservation issues surrounding these snakes. Being bitten comes with the territory. And as I said again, I'm really careful. But if you're into hands-on science, hands-on research, whether it's crocs, snakes, turtles, whatever, accidents happen. You just try to minimize those accidents and make sure that they're not fatal accidents. And, you know, I've had friends and colleagues that are herpetologists that sadly lost their life in pursuit of knowledge. And as I said, it comes with the territory. You just have to be careful in dealing with these animals.
You don't mess around with them, definitely not.
Not the venomous ones. You know, back in the old days, I was grabbing venomous snakes right and left and not even thinking about it. And, you know, then I lost a good buddy of mine. And then I had children. And you start thinking about the odds. And when my friend was killed, he didn't do anything wrong. And you can do everything by the book. And there's an unexpected element.
There's always that element.
An element of surprise with these animals, and things can go wrong. You sneeze, you blink, you look away, you slip, and if you're bitten by some of these snakes, you can be bitten in a hospital by some species of snakes, and you're still probably going to die. That's how deadly some of these animals are.
Well, my next question was actually going to be, how do people overcome their fear of snakes?
Well, and that's a great question, because I deal with people all the time, and a lot of people are afraid of snakes. And I think that they've never held them. They've never looked at them. I mean, they're magnificent creatures. You may see this thing's tongue flicking. It's actually tasting the air. It has a specialized organ inside of its mouth So it's tasting the air just like we smell. It's gathering in its environment. That snake also sees the world in a thermal image. If you look very closely along its upper lip, it has some holes on its face.
That's a nose, right?
No. Those are specialized thermal organs that detect minute temperature differences. This thing preys upon warm-blooded animals, birds and mammals. You can cover up its eyes, or you can put it in a cave in total darkness, and it still sees its environment. When you put your hands down on this desktop,
you feel that,
and warm it up,
right?
That snake sees a red handprint wherever you touch. It's warming
up. It's like
up.
You see a movie, is it?
Exactly. It's like the movie Predator. You know, that it can detect temperature differences as minute as like 1/10,000th of 1 degree. So with this thermal image and the tongue, it's sensing the world in ways we can't even imagine. It doesn't even need its eyes, and it has good eyesight to boot.
It's incredible what a snake, I mean, to me it's just like one thing, but it's doing so much. But some people are so afraid of snakes. We have a tendency to avoid the things or to get rid of the things that we are not familiar with and that we don't know about. Should people live peacefully with snakes, or should they just be gotten rid of altogether?
No, and you know, that's you know, I get up on my soapbox on a daily basis and say, look, we as people like to protect our warm and cuddly animals, our adorable koala bears, our pandas,
yeah.
Animals like that. The cold and scalies need your love too. I mean, these guys are just as important as the warm and fuzzy animals.
How so? How are they important?
Well, many snakes, I mean, look, everything's important. We know that everything is interconnected in the web of life. There's animals that depend on this species and animals that depend on the species it depends upon. But many snakes are called what is a keystone species. And that's analogous to a keystone in a building. Every building has a keystone, and if you remove that stone, the building collapses. Well, if you remove a keystone species, the ecosystem can collapse. They're that important. So, you know, in the grand scheme of things, we as humans need to protect everything. It's so wrong to kill them out of fear and ignorance, you know, persecute these animals. Ah, it's something evil. It might be venomous, so let's kill it. I'm not sure if it's venomous or not. And you just can't do that. Snakes aren't aggressive. They're not going to come after you. They're not going to chase you. If you see one in the wild, man, take away that it's an incredible encounter. Don't try to touch it. Don't hurt it. Don't approach it. It's just like any other wild animal. It's a wild animal trying to make a living.
What you're talking about, that it plays an important role in the life, in the web of life. What role does it play other than just scaring people?
Well, these guys right here are big rodent eaters. They regulate rodent problems. You get rid of all your constrictors, man, you're going to be overrun with rats and mice, which carry diseases which are transmitted to humans. They eat our food. They eat our grain stores. You know, then you got a bunch of rats and people are complaining you got too many rats. Well, if you didn't kill all your snakes, you wouldn't have a rodent problem.
So keep your snakes. Keep your snakes.
Snakes are your friends. They're just as lovable as the warm and cuddly mammals.
Well, thank you, Dr. Brady Barr.
You're welcome.
That's all the questions for I had, and that does it for this week's Soft Power. Stay tuned next week as we continue our discussion on snakes here on Soft Power. I'm Gino Wong.